I first heard reggae music in shell camp. Shell camp in Tema, where my father was serving in the military. And I remember even the soldiers used to always go to Middle East to go serve on the UN. Most of them were part of the UN peacekeeping forces. So when they were returning, they would always bring records that weren't available. They would bring them, they would buy them from Egypt and all these other places and bring them to the barracks. So that was where I started really hearing kind of people playing it, you know. But the first time it really moved me was when I went to a rehearsal by the 1st Battalion of Infantry Band called Classic Hot Barrels. And they were playing a Bob Marley song. And that was when I really was inspired by reggae music, when I first heard that. You know, at first, you know, I'd heard like a few, you know, you hear it around, you know, like songs like Soja Say, you know. But the song that really I remember clearly making an impact on me was Coming In From The Cold. You know, Bob Marley's Coming In From The Cold. Because that band used to, they were rehearsing constantly, and I sat in on a lot of the rehearsals. And afterwards, I was really, really moved by it. And then beyond that, I started really looking out and seeking the music myself. So Coming In From The Cold was really a song that really kind of established it for me. I remember I was around 5 years old, and I had been, you know, music was really something that at that time I was very interested. So as a kid, I was just like really formulating stuff. And by the time I was like around 7, I felt confident enough that I could make up songs. So I was making up songs, and what I would do is I would sing it to friends and then tell them, oh, I heard it somewhere, just to hear their reaction, you know. And they'll be like, oh, that's a good song. They're like, okay, I'm doing something good. So it was around 7 years old when I first really started formulating my own songs. And then, you know, they were kind of, I'll say, not really professionally realized, but that was, those were the fundamentals, the building blocks of what eventually became a songwriting ability. Beyond that, you know, my music started really evolving, and when I went to secondary school, Tamil secondary school, first of all, what I started doing was I started singing in the dorm rooms. I was a very noisy kid, you know. Everybody complained about me, you know, but I was the guy who would not shut up, you know, the guy who always in the room would start with a bunch of sticks with a lot of people singing. And we always created concert events in our dorm room. So beyond that, you know, from after secondary school, I went to sixth form in New Job in Ikoforidua, where I also kind of really kept evolving it. But professionally, I hadn't sang yet till I got to University of Ghana, where me and my colleagues formed our first band called Local Crisis on the campus of University of Ghana. And that was how it really started. From university, I left for the United States of America, you know, where I decided that I wanted to professionally get into music. But to get into music professionally too, I felt that I needed to get myself educated, because, you know, first of all, I went to a lot of the producers in Ghana, and they told me that like high life music is really the music. So, you know, I don't know, we are not able to kind of, you want to do reggae music, and we think that a market like that is going to be hard unless you really leave Ghana, you know. So I felt a great conviction that this was the kind of music I wanted to do, because I also wanted to use that music as a means to communicate, and at the same time to use it to advocate, you know. So there was the need for me to really leave the environs of Ghana and try to seek a bigger world, and also be able to get the knowledge that I knew was required for me to take my music and be able to push my music forward. So in the US, I ended up interning for a record label, and then I ended up working for the record label doing promotions. And then through that, I was able to learn the way that music was marketed. And afterwards, I came to Ghana, established my first label, Aprilia Records, recorded my first album, The Movement. And then that really launched my career. And songs like What Goes Around and then Sugar from that first album really kind of started establishing me within Ghana. And then they were, What Goes Around was also licensed for a compilation that Atlantic Records put together called Reggae the Next Generation. So right from the first album, I got an opportunity to be introduced to an international audience. And that was what also started building my career and my notoriety to outside of Ghana. So beyond that, you know, Aquarian Records too started getting stronger, and I kept evolving the music, and till now, when the music has actually been able to, you know, really expand beyond the borders of Ghana to so many places around the world. Now, when you live in Ghana, you have an idea of the way things are, and you operate upon those presuppositions, you know, you operate upon those assumptions. But once you start traveling outside the country, you also see that people listen to different styles of music. People move to different grooves, and people kind of perceive rhythm too in a different way. So once I started knowing that, I started really kind of being open to every country that I travel to really seep and immerse myself in kind of the rhythmic language of that country. And in doing so too, gradually be able to integrate some of those elements into my music as I gradually adapt my music or progress it to become a much more universal voice and its appeal be bigger beyond the borders of Ghana and be much more global. And I think that that education and that knowledge of interaction helped mold my music and make my music much more accessible to an audience that's universal. Apart from the concerts that I've done, my music has also been used in, you know, very big TV shows in the US, from ER to Dexter to Weeds, I've had opportunity to of having my music also present on very world famous and high selling video games like the FIFA series, from the World Cup series to all the EA titles to Sims, which is also very, very, very big and has a huge audience. So from very young kids who will be exposed to my music to the youth to much more older, sophisticated people to who are into music that communicates, music that is mature. So it's giving me an audience that I think really cuts across. Well, I like to advise all the artists, because, the thing is that the relevance of, because it's all music, so, and the importance of your music, that you gotta have the music not totally cornered and sectionalized as reggae or world music. Every artist that succeeds has to be able to be accepted multi-platform. I am booked on from jazz festivals to world music festivals to rock festivals to reggae festivals to spiritual festivals. So as an artist, you have to have the ability to have that expanse for people to be able to, and it all takes certain finesse to be able to do that. Because, when it comes to just only reggae, the market is very small, on the global scale, when you start really traveling around and seeing that, although reggae is very big here and there in our parts of the world, but in the bigger expanse of the world, it's only a certain sector. So you have to also have the ability to be able to play reggae music that has transcendence, that is also appeals to people who are interested in other genres. It requires a certain level of knowledge and quality. So My advice to the reggae artists, first of all, is that, you know, you have to understand that the music, the Jamaicans can play it, you know, much better than you do in terms of understanding it. But your advantage is that because you are seeing reggae music through the spectacles of Africa, the inclusion and also elements of African music that you add to expand the boundaries of the music creates a new direction for it. And that is what catches the ear of people. The innovation that is happening in reggae, I believe, is happening through African music, because most of the Jamaicans themselves too originally came from Africa, they are our brothers. So we understand that music from its most fundamental level. So, but when we are able to integrate it and also speak it in our language, I think it assumes a bigger expanse, bigger impact. And that is why I feel that my music has also had the opportunity of being accepted globally. Kenya, sisi sote.